Great. So thank you, Gareth, for introduction. And hello, everybody. Today, I will be talking about code performance optimization in MATLAB. And I will be talking about what we've done in qubit. So it will be qubit case study. So let's go. So first of all, I would like to give you some overview of today's talk. So here is agenda. So I will start by briefly introducing Quikersim and tell you what we do in Quikersim. Next, I will just give you a high-level overview of what is qubit and what is it for. And next, I think this will be the most interesting part. So I will be sharing what, as developers, we have learned during qubit development and also during prior projects with code examples. And today, I will be focusing mainly on the data structures and especially access times, data types, so performance of comparing different data types like characters, integers, and strings. Also, performance of sparse and full matrices. So, when to use sparse matrix, when to use full matrix, which one consume less memory, which one runs faster in terms of in case of different densities of your matrix. And last, I will talk about lookup tables and interpolators, and also I will discuss difference between interp and grid interpolant. And at the end, I will try to sum up all of the things that I will be doing during my presentation, and just present to you like guidelines for high performance code architecture in MATLAB. Okay, so to start with, in the Quikersim, we've got like four main fields and four main project types. So first, and I think the most important type is custom applications and in-house software. And this is mainly focused on graphical user interface, which we create using Guide, using App Designer, also using JavaScript. Of course, there are also tailored numerical models which we design and implement. This is like our core skill in the company. There are also numerical libraries and web applications that in recent years we are also developing for our clients. And the next field are off-the-shelf software, so basically often these custom applications and in-house software are good enough that we try to sell them to the another clients. And in our case, it is CFD Toolbox. So this is a toolbox for computational fluid dynamics from MATLAB. This is also QHVAC. So this is application for heat ventilation and air conditioning calculations also for MATLAB. And there is also qubit. So this is like our flagship product now. And as Gareth mentioned before, this is a product for battery simulation, but I will give you more information in the next slide. There is also engineering consulting, mainly CFD simulations, and R&D projects and funded projects. And as you can see, as you can tick from the icons below, in all of these fields, we are using MATLAB. So we try to basically come up with the best guidelines for writing MATLAB code. Okay, and what is qubit? Qubit is basically MATLAB-based software for unsteady thermal simulation of battery packs. And what differs qubit for other commercial CFD tools is that it uses physical-driven reduced order model methods, and it also supports full nonlinear parameters. And thanks to that, we are able to carry out simulation of charging, discharging, cooling battery packs in almost real time. So just to let you know, we are almost 1,000 faster, 1,000 times faster in comparison to CFD2s like Ansys Fluent and Star CCM. And this is why we are focusing so much on writing high performance code. And also our software is fully integrated with Simulink. So we are able to generate model for Simulink from every possible model that you can create in Qubit. And here we are using MATLAB system class for that. And thanks to that, user can run level system level simulation and maintain like information about full 3D temperature distributions. Okay, and so let's talk about code. And first of all, I would like to start with data structures. So at the beginning of Qubit development, we had to come up with basically diagram for classes and structures and all of that, and we have to come up with idea how to store data. And in case of Qubit, it's really important because when you talk about battery packs, there are a lot of components. In each battery pack, there can be over 1,000 cells and even more passive heat components, cooling plates, and all of that stuff. So basically, each of these components is represented by an object in our software, and to be more specific, in our model class. So we have to first think how to encapsulate this object inside our objects, and what's even more important, how the deepness of this encapsulation will affect the performance. To check that out, we basically created many toy examples, and here you see one in which we are comparing access times between one level deep structure, two level deep structure, vector and matrix. And basically we done that to assess whether we should use deep structures or not. And also we would like just for fun to compare it with MATLAB containers, MATLAB specific containers like vector and matrix. So here you can see the results, and maybe they are not very counterintuitive, but I think they're interesting. So in case of one level deep structure, it took almost one and a half second to access it 1 million times. In case of two level deep structure, the time is almost twice as long. So it's case pretty linear. But in case when we use vector or matrix, well, basically vectors are 1D matrix, the time is much, the access time is much lower. So here we can see that it's only 0.08 seconds, which is pretty fast. And conclusions that we made here is that in case of our computational engine and functions with a lot of hits during simulation, it is better to use shallow structures. And the best way, the most efficient way to access data in MATLAB is to use basically matrix. And if you use like homogeneous data in your model or in your class, and it is the same level, so the best way to incorporate this data into your model is by matrix.
Michael, sorry to interrupt you here. There's a couple of questions here that might be worth answering before you continue.
Okay.
So question number one here is, which version of MATLAB are you using? In other words, or which versions of MathWorks tools do you support? So I think the underlying question is, performance has changed per release. There's new features that come out, and what are your benchmarks? So that's one question.
Yeah, that's a very good question. And these benchmarks were done on MATLAB 2020B. In case of Qubit, we support MATLAB 2018B. That's the oldest version of MATLAB that we support. And yeah, of course, that's true that performance in MATLAB changes from version to version. And well, I will be talking about that a bit later.
Okay, very good. And then the other question that came through is, well, it's a bit of an observation, like love the fact that you're using dark mode. But I think the underlying question there was, you use the tick in the top command. Did you use the performance unit testing framework from the MathWorks to do a more in-depth analysis? So, you know, so the first time you run something in MATLAB, it's a little bit slower, but then the second and the third, there's these warm-ups that as you do it more and more often, you get a bit of performance. Did you take that into account in your decisions, or was this TikTok just a simple example that to show talk?
Yeah, sure. So first of all, if we are not like developing new code, so we are trying to optimize like the old code. For us to start is to just run the profiler and check which parts are slow. So basically, to find low hanging fruits. And then there, during like optimization process, we just try to check in the command window or basically other scripts how our improvements can change these runtimes. And after making sure that our improvement will decrease the runtime of this function or application, then we incorporate into our environment and change it in our application.
Very good, thank you.
Okay. Next will be data types comparison. And the genesis for this problem is that we, as I mentioned before, there are a lot of cells in battery assemblies. And basically, each cell has like this electrogrid class that that defines its electric properties, but also the electric model, which will be run under the hood in the qubit. And in qubit, we are using something called equivalent circuit model, and there are a lot of different equivalent circuit model, which basically differs in number of resistors and capacitors which they use. So we had to implement a different logic for each of this model, and we were wondering what is the most efficient way to evaluate if else statements a lot of times, because in our software we have to run this electrical solver with timestamps of like 1 millisecond. So for sure there's this function with a high number of hits. So we were wondering which data types should we use in case of this circuit type property of electrogrid, which, as can you see in the picture in the lower right corner, is then used to basically choose the logic that will be run in our model. We were wondering if we should choose strings or car arrays or maybe integers. And we come up with other toy example. Here, as you can see, will be basically comparing 100 million times different data types. So the first one is string comparison. The second one is integer 16 comparison. And next we've got, long character array and short character array. And yeah, these results were for sure counterintuitive. So to start with strings, they run pretty slow, especially comparison of strings, and more advanced function on strings. These are pretty slow in MATLAB. So as you can see, it almost took 40 seconds to evaluate this part of code. And the thing that surprised me is that there is almost no difference in case of performance in comparing integers and character arrays. This is pretty counterintuitive to me. And as you can see here, in this case, comparison of character arrays is even slightly faster. So we've decided to use characterize because, well, basically it is easier for the developer to read code if there are comparisons between characterize and not like enums or ints. And yeah, and using our conclusions was that using strings comparison in if-else statements with high number of hits can severely decrease performance of application. And it is always better to use int or character comparisons, especially in your computational engine. Okay, and the next thing that we've tried to measure the performance of was sparse versus full matrix representation. So in Qubit, we do a lot of algebra. So basically, there are mesh manipulations, there are projection operators, there are linear system of equations that we have to solve. And all of that are basically matrices. So we wanted to know when should we store matrices in sparse format to minimize memory consumption, but also what's even, I think, more important for us is when to use sparse matrix format to maximize our performance. And like bonus question for us was how much faster are basic operations on matrices, so addition and element wise multiplication on GPU. And yeah, in case of memory, I think that these results are quite intuitive. So I'll just maybe give you an overview of this example. We've decided to test different matrices with different number of non-zero elements. So this is represented by density in this plot on the x-axis. And in this case, we've experimented on the square matrix with 25 million values. So as you can see here, and as I mentioned before, it's quite intuitive. So basically, it's better to use full matrix format if you have more than 50%, if non-zero values are more than 50% of your matrix. And below that, it's better to use sparse matrix representation. And yeah, this is pretty basic stuff. But the results from the performance basic operations runtime. So these are not so intuitive. So here you can see on the left, here are plots of runtimes for add and element-wise multiplication on sparse and full matrix on CPU. And on the right, you can see the same on GPU. And in case of CPU, we can see that if our matrix density is smaller than 15%, it is better to use sparse format. So here it is more efficient in case of runtimes. And in case of GPU, well, and this is quite strange for me, but in case of GPU, it is always better to use full matrix format. And maybe what's even more interesting, sparse event-wise multiplication on GPU is quite slower than sparse addition. So we also try to evaluate that on bigger matrix. So in this case, it is also 25 million elements, square matrix. And yeah, in case of CPU, the results are pretty similar. Maybe the threshold of density moved to like 20%, but the results look quite similar. And in case of GPU, where they are the same as in the previous example. So here also using full representation is always faster, and sparse multiplication, sparse element-wise multiplication is much slower. So yeah, so here are our conclusions. So in case of memory usage, it is better to use sparse format when the density of the matrix is lower than 50%. In case of CPU performance, it's better to use sparse format when density of matrix is lower than 15%. And in case of GPU, as for MATLAB 20B, it's always better to use full matrix representation, and sparse matrix multiplication is much slower than addition on GPU. And I believe that even in this example, we can see that sparse multiplication on GPU is slower than sparse multiplication on CPU. So yeah, this is also a stretch. But yeah, these are our conclusions. And the last topic, so the lookup tables. So the genesis for us to analyze this problem is that in Qubit, as I've mentioned, there are all of the components can have nonlinear parameters, and nonlinear parameters mean that we have to implement some kind of interpolation or use some kind of interpolation. And in Qubit, we also have a lot of function handles. And for example, we have in the cooling plates, there is coolant, and it has nonlinear thermal parameters. And we would like to calculate enthalpy, so we have to compute integral of some kind of function. And we know that function a priori. So we are wondering if creating a lookup table for this function, how much faster the code will run if we do that, and how big error we are introduced to our code if we go with the lookup table. And we had to also consider that we are generating C code in case of Simulink model. So the question was, can we use the same functions in both MATLAB and Simulink? And also, we wanted to find the fastest way to evaluate interpolate nonlinear parameters. And the experiments that we have done, they were made on the function that you can see on the right. So on the left, you can see the change of relative error, maximal and min, in terms of data points that were used to fit the interpolate function. So the error drops pretty fast. We were not considered about the error in our case. And we saw the high performance gains that you can see in the figure on the right. So basically, using interpolant, interp function is almost 10 times faster than using integral in our case. So next we've decided that we want to know, should we use interp or grid interpolant? And we've started with 1D case. As it turned out, it is better to use grid interpolant in 1D case. It's much faster. And it is even faster in 2D cases. And in Qubit, when it comes to cells, for example, cell resistance can depend on temperature, but also SOC, so state of charge of the cell. So we also use a lot of 2D interpolation. And as you can see in this example, the evaluation time of grid interpolant in case of two dimensions does not change a lot with number of data points. But in case of interp2, it changed quite a lot. So only on this plot, it rises like 10 times. So our conclusions here was that if we know a function and its ranges before running calculations, the best way to approach this is just to tabulate it and make some kind of interpolation. In case of pure MATLAB applications, it is better to use gridded interpolant class, especially in case of high dimensional data. And in case of code generation, grid interpolant is unfortunately not supported yet. So we had to go with interps. And what's also good to know about interps is that they struggle with extrapolation, especially in case of high dimensional data.
So Michael, sorry, before you continue, there's a few questions that have been coming in that I think maybe good place to ask you. So Raghu is asking a question saying, he says it's interesting that you're using Simulink Coder instead of MATLAB Coder. Is there a particular reason why you did the code generation from Simulink and not from MATLAB, where it seems most your code so far is primarily MATLAB based?
Yeah, that's a good question. Basically, at the beginning, we just tried to create our Simulink model as interpreted one, so it doesn't have to be compiled. But then one of our clients, he said that they need compiled model to that can be run across the platforms and across other softwares. So then we basically started wondering how we can refactor our code as soon as possible to just run in the Simulink in the code generation mode. And this is why we've gone with the Simulink and Simulink Coder.
Okay, very good. There's another question which is interesting. Came from a little earlier in your presentation. Did you evaluate the performance between a U16 and N32? And this was referring to when we were looking at the sparse versus the comparison of sparse and dense matrices.
Yeah, that's a very good question. I believe that we've done that, but unfortunately, I don't have an example ready. But yeah, there was time that we basically tried to evaluate performance of each basic MATLAB data container type, and I'm pretty sure that we've checked that, but unfortunately I don't have it on my slides, so sorry for that.
Not a problem. Maybe what we can do is when we push this live, you can add some information to it on the channel.
Sure.
Then there's another question from Yadis, which is actually also interesting, is do you have some practical benchmarks for your application between single core and multi-core processing? And I think the question there is there a difference between using the parallel computing toolbox, yes or no?
Yes, they are. In fact, we implemented some functions using parallel toolbox. So for example, when we've got like this many components, there are also contacts between these components, and we can like create them using fully parallel solutions. And there are also solvers like, well, in our software, you can use ML divide, but you can also use, you can also switch to the PCG solver. And we've measured the speed up. And it was in case of model assimilation, it is like, or it depends obviously on numbers of cores that you have, but it was like 4 to 5 times. And in case of online stage, it was like something near 10 times faster in case of using PCG, which is highly parallelized, but yeah.
So then there's another question here is, so it's clear that you're developing tools on top of MathWorks ecosystem and you're selling them. When you develop your tools, do you assume, and you're optimizing for performance, do you assume your customers have the parallel computing toolbox? Or do you assume like, okay, maybe they don't have it, so let's optimize assuming that they don't have it?
Well, basically, we optimize it for parallel toolbox, but we support customers that don't have parallel toolbox. So basically, in case if customer doesn't have parallel toolbox, then there is just like warning that this can be done faster with parallel toolbox, but we go with the slower part of code.
Very good. And then one last question is, because we're talking of the parallel computing toolbox and the GPU element, Nana is asking is, which tools did you use to enable GPU computing?
Well, I don't know if I fully understand the question. Well, in case of GPU computing, we are basically using GPU arrays that are provided with the parallel toolbox. And I think that's all that I can say.
So that answers the question. So you're using the parallel computing toolbox to enable outside the MathWorks ecosystem that you can buy. That's something you're using with the MathWorks parallel computing toolbox.
Yeah, sure. You can always like implement max function and try to do that in C or C++, but well, it takes much more effort. And maybe we'll do that in future because parallel toolbox has also its limitation. It consumes very large amount of memory. But currently we're sticking to the parallel MATLAB toolbox.
Very good, very good. So please continue. Sorry, there was lots of interesting questions that popped up all of a sudden.
Sure. Basically that's the end of my presentation. So I will just summarize, I will try to summarize all the things that I've said before. And so basically, there are like two layers of application in case of MATLAB and high performance computing that we come up with. There is user interface and there is computational engine. And basically user interface should be user friendly, which is pretty obvious, but it should support name value arguments. It should have a lot of arguments validators. It should handle all the data casting. Well, graphical interface is also part of user interface. User interface should also handle I/O, and it should be developed in that so that it should be highly readable code. So the maintenance should go before performance here. And from our experience, it is also really good and it makes things easier to use. OOP, so object-oriented programming in case of user interface, and high encapsulation is also and the user interface is good place to use that. Basically, because it should be highly readable code, it should be highly user-friendly, and the performance, you know, is not the key point in case of user interface. But all of that changes in terms of computational engine. So first and foremost, architects should always design apps taking into account modularity so that there can be another features that will be coming in the future. Functions should have a well-defined interface, asset vars, name values, and so on as possible, because all of that affects performance. There should be no data casting and as close to zero as possible if else statements, because basically they are also performance killers. And it is best to use shallow data object structures. And that's it. Thank you for your attention. And if there are any more questions, I would be happy to answer them.
Yes, so there's a few more questions. So so Jan should be getting ready as we speak. So let me just ask the last few questions. Mm-hmm. So one of them is, and most likely this came from the previous presenter, when you write the code, right, so you are developing new code, how do you enforce standards? Is this something that you have a specific way of doing this?
We've got like in-house code style guide, which every new employee has to know. And we've also, during merge request, we review code. And if we see that something violates our standards, we then just, well, blame the developer that pushed that code onto our repository. But yeah, we don't use any automatic ways to like ensure that we have that we are good with our code standards.
Very good, very good. There's another interesting question that comes from Michelle, which is, have you tried using the function argument validation? So the argument block, which came out, I believe, in 19b, for input validation to design easy to use functions? And yep. So do you have any advice?
Yep, we've done that. And recently we had to delete this part of codes, which was a bit for us. But basically, we use that because I think this is the most user-friendly way that MathWorks come up with to provide interface for functions. And as developers, we were like, yay, let's use that. It's really cool. But then our clients started to basically start telling us that they use MATLAB 2070B or 2080B and our code is not running. So basically we had to just remove all of that from our code and write our own validators, which basically were able to evaluate on older MATLAB versions. And yeah, we done that. So basically, if your code does not need to run on older MATLABs, arguments are a really nice way to check inputs for the function. But if in the future your code will have to run on older MATLAB versions, it is better to stick with your validators or older MATLAB functionality as vararchs or something like that.
Very good. And then the last question before we hand it over to Jan. It seems that you've collected quite a lot of deep knowledge of how the math works or the MATLAB engine works. How do you train your new developers to get to a stage where they can do what you do or think about the problem you do? Do you kind of go through official training? Do you have a roadmap internally? Do you go back to the universities close to you and say, dear professors, teach this? How do you go about by getting people to the same place where you are?
Yeah, that's a very good question. And this is something that we are trying to improve in our company. But basically, we've got like these tech meetups. So every month we've got like meetup for all of the developers in our company, and we are presenting results from projects or like this kind of stuff. So weird quirks of MATLAB. There are also assignments for the new employees that we do. So to just speed up the process of learning. And in case of new employees, we also right now try to incorporate this like mentoring program. So every new employee can have like his older buddy, which can help him with like these things. So try to improve code performance and all of that stuff.